Hey guys, here we are on the Lahakai.
This is Luke, and I'm Lori, and we're sailing the skeleton boat without a motor down south with Ben from Sailing YABA as our crew. You asked for it, and we heard you, so this is going to be an extra special feature-length episode. So grab your popcorn and get ready, because we're going to take you on a wild journey into the sea. And we are taking you with us, so don't forget to subscribe, like this video, and ring that bell to keep the journey alive. Last week, we showed you how we prepared our empty steel sailboat to sail. We are only in the middle of the construction on our boat, and we were forced to move her to another location. Where, might you ask? 384 nautical miles south. There's no interior on our boat, and our electrical motor is still in the box and can't be installed. So we're gonna have to let the wind take us as far as we can get.
Hey guys, here we are on the Lahakai, finally ready to embark. We have fixed everything up. Actually, we're a little more prepared than we thought we were going to be. We have boarded up the windows because we're gonna actually sandblast the interior, so we do not need to have the windows right now. And it would kind of be an expense that's unnecessary. We installed our refurbished sails. We have finished the mast. We have installed the boom. We have created this badass little system here. We have our little, I don't know, it's like a, you know, little hut you see in the fairs, but actually it's pretty amazing. I think that maybe we'll use this style when we actually create the final thing. And of course we have packed everything that we could possibly pack of our lives inside the empty hull, and we're ready to go. We have food, we have water, we have our little cat who is giving up right now. He's just settling in, and we have friends to see us off with little empanadas, and we're off. It's been a lot of work. It's been fun, it's been hard, it's been difficult, it's been up and down, so a big roller coaster, but I think we're ready to go, and we're excited for our new location. I think we're still floating. Here we are. It is our maiden voyage. We have taken off, and our friend Felipe has given us a little tow in the front to get all the way to Copacabana, which is it's pretty good distance for us to get wind, because right now, as you can see with these waters, there is no wind here. We are going to be lifting this thingy, but we haven't done it right now, just in case there's any sort of emergencies and we need to do anything quickly, because we do not have a motor on this boat. Our emergency and backup motor is right here, and it's a temporary motor, and eventually we're going to have an electric one, but for now, this is what we have. We are motoring up to Copacabana. We are putting everything away. The crew is working diligently. The captain is at the helm, and we are off.
We are embarking on a crossing going from Rio de Janeiro to Santa Catarina, Brazil. That's 384 nautical miles south. And just as soon as we're on our way, our journey comes to an abrupt halt. Big Rider, the boat towing us, has an oil leak, so we have to look for another way to get to open water.
Wow! Let go?
Cannibal.
It was really nice this time.
However, our luck does not seem to be on our side on this sunny day.
So this is how our great first launch went. We are drifting around aimlessly in the bay. Our friend who is going to tow us to Copacabana, his engine has oil problems and is now dead in the water. So we have wistfully and quickly launched our dinghy and we sent it on its way to fetch another boat. And our dinghy appears to be now dead in the water as well. So we are three boats adrift in the water. I think we made it about 5 minutes into the water. So it's not as serious as us. I mean, right, if you could see right there, this is where we started. And this is where we are. I believe that means our 3 to 5 day journey might be 20 to 37 days at this rate.
But not all heroes wear capes. The Emo Soish finally appears and saves the day. The Emo Soish, meaning emotions in Portuguese, was true to its name. She brought us to the mouth of the bay as we waited anxiously for the journey ahead. So much had happened not only in the last hour, but in the last 6 months, and our emotions were swirling around our heads and our hearts.
That dinghy broke down on its way to get the Emo Soish, and now the Emo Soish picked up Big Rider, brought it back to the marina, and is now towing us to where there is wind, which is definitely not here. You can see this very placid water. You can tell that we are not really going that far. And so now we're being towed. Let's hope that this works this time.
And just like that, the wind filled our sails and our tiny little tugboat faded into the distance.
Guess what, babe? We're sailing.
Sailing.
I said, babe, I really want to go sailing one day, so we bought a sailboat.
No engine.
No engine.
No engine. So we got stuck for a couple hours right in front of, I believe it's just Copacabana, without any wind. We didn't get very far, and to our luck, Jeremiah and Bronx came to rescue us, and they are pulling us out to deeper water where hopefully there will be wind. And a couple hours later, on our journey, we haven't made it super far. We certainly had a lot of people help us along the way, so that's nice. I got a little sick because we spilled gas all over the place. I am super excited to not have any engines that involve gas in it because the smell makes me super nauseous. And I think between a little bit of the stress, the motion of the boat being stuck in the water and the smell of the gas just was a little too much for me. I'm not sick, but I'm certainly not feeling it. Here we are being towed by Jeremiah the Frog. Stop with Jeremiah. And let's see if we can find some wind.
Nope. There was no wind in our sails, and with heavy hearts, we flagged down a passing fishing boat, and it kindly towed us back to a safe spot to pass the night and regroup for the morning. Our trip started promising as we left the bay going around 6 knots. We followed the charts along the coastal line, and this was probably our first mistake. As we ducked between the islands and close to the shoreline, the wind died down and never returned. We were towed a little further out, but it was not good enough to escape the mountains robbing us from precious wind.
Thank you.
so we formulated a new plan. We would leave the bay and we would head straight out to sea this time and see if Mother Nature would be kinder to us out there.
And by your definition of so fast right now?
4.5 knots. Yesterday we were doing zero, like any speed now is fast.
It's true.
Our rigging was very much improvised as well. It was made up of a mix of pulleys and miscellaneous clips. Have you ever noticed that the less resources you have, the more creative you get? Like the spinnaker Ben made from an aluminum pole that we found in the boat. With nothing but time on our hands, we could think of all the ways we can invent things along the way. Our boat looked even rougher than the old worn and wooden fishing trawlers that we would pass by. Our windows boarded up, a tarp as a bimini, and our sails stained from time. But all the things that seemed important sitting in the marina no longer seemed to matter in the water. One can argue that our design is not the most desirable, but no one can deny that our boat was doing what it was made to do. It was sailing. Or at least it was sailing until it wasn't anymore. We had been cruising along in the night with a gentle breeze on our backs when the helm became unresponsive. We put the emergency tiller on and continued till the wind died down and we could take a good look at what went wrong. Our steering cables had fallen off the radial drive and Ben did his best to temporarily fix it. Though the system was newly installed and tested, there seemed to be something up with the installation that we would have to look into when we arrive.
Okay. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, leave it. I'll tighten it.
Hello.
Oh, you're filming. Mm-hmm. Exciting stuff down there. This means serious business.
But the wind never returned for us to test it out, and the coastal line was visible. Not knowing when we would gain control again and not wanting to stray too close to land, we decided it would be safer if we would call for a tow. With our friends in contact, we were able to pay a fisherman to bring us 3 hours till we were safe in the harbor of Ubatuba. So in the middle of that night, we held on tight to our tiny little emergency tiller from what seemed like an eternity. The force of the water pushing back and forth on the rudder, the waning light playing tricks on our minds. Time seemed to drag on and on and on. It's funny how quickly plans can go to waste. We can try to plan our day, our year, or even our lives. And just as quickly as we write our intentions down, like New Year's resolutions, it can all fall apart. Even in our circumstance, people say that we got lucky. We were given this boat. We had money to burn. We are entitled. But they don't know about all the plans we had made. The years of saving up money, careful budgeting, the sacrifices, the long days, the hard work. We planned on getting a small boat and simple living. And how those plans have changed. But when plans fall apart, does it mean that you have failed? I suppose if this is what failure looks like, it can't be that bad. Perhaps the difference between plans made and plans failed is that you actually tried. Here we are in Ubatuba. We didn't make it to Ilabela, and we certainly didn't make it to Navaganchis. And though this looks very luxurious, I feel like we have just recovered from war. Now, some would say that that was predictable, and I would say you're right. We tried our best to do things as fast as possible, and we were under a lot of time constraints, so we really pushed it to our limits. And unfortunately, this region has very, very little wind. So no matter how prepared we were not prepared for no wind. Unfortunately, we did not have an outboard motor, we didn't have an inboard motor, we didn't have a motor. We did have an outboard motor on our dinghy, but on day one, this failed us. Actually, a lot of things failed us. And I guess that's also part of building a boat from scratch, is also learning what needs to be fixed, because it doesn't come factory settings perfect.
Ben returned home, and we stayed to contemplate our next move. With no wind in the forecast, we couldn't even attempt to go on, so we decided we would go ahead and scout out the new location. Since we had never seen it before, we could prepare for when the boat actually arrives. And by chance, our friends Chicama floated in, and we were also going in the same direction. So our sailing trip turned into a road trip as Mother Nature tested our patience. We study the winds, and at the first window we had, Ben and Luke jumped on a bus back to Ubatuba to complete the journey, and I stayed behind to continue working.
Ready for our part two of the adventure. We're back in Saco da Ribeira, Ubatuba. Luke and myself, the boat's kind of okay.
Everything's good.
I haven't seen it because I left before them, but look what they did with the... I'm gonna show you around. Here is the aluminium tender. This is the improv door they made. Everything's still in place, but now, as it doesn't have a lock, we're gonna have to just tear it apart. Oh yeah,
okay, let's
give it a go. Yeah. Before we leave, there are three main jobs we wanted to do. First one being the quadrant. You might be wondering why there is a tiny emergency tiller instead of this beautiful wheel. That's because the wires of the quadrant actually came loose, and we're gonna fasten them again. When that's done, we'll be ready to sail. But then for that, we're also gonna need the sail.
being both sails operable, which means we're going to install the two winches as well, which last time we thought we could do without, but we'd rather just have it properly done. So we're going to install the winches as well, starboard and port, and then we're also going to install the different rigging for the main sheet to make it a lot easier when we're doing our night shifts, night watches, and we have to manage the boat alone. So I think that's it, right?
Yep.
So these need to be nice and tight around here, and also nice and tight going up to the wheel, which they are not. And that has to be fixed. Do you have a chave inglaise? I think this is finished, so it's nice and tight over there, and it's nice and tight over there, and I've put three nuts on just in case so it doesn't come loose.
Next on the list
is the winch.
2022 model.
Instead of using the winch stands that we had created, they decided to move the winches forward so they could sit on the side while sailing. This is a design change we will address before finalizing the cockpit, and one of the most positive results from the sea test. We were able to test if our designs worked in action. These little details really go a long way to making the boat more comfortable. As Luke was installing the winches, Ben was working on upgrading the improvised traveler with design 2.0.
We were completely ready to leave until we got on the dinghy to go and pick up some last fuel for the outboard engine. Yeah. When we realized the rudder and the keel are completely full of green marine life. So we're gonna go down with a brush, an old spatula, and just scrape it all off and then leave. That's the plan.
We are leaving Ubatuba, and there's a small window of good wind, and we will try to reach in Itajaí. I don't know. It's 2 days, maybe 2 days and a half, but we'll try.
So Ben jumped in the dinghy, and Luke held down the helm, and they towed the boat to open water in search of wind. Thank you. hour, they had left the bay, but were still quite inland. Around 2 hours, the motoring continued without any signs of wind. They checked out how much gas they had and agreed, there was no giving up now. Finally, around 3 hours out, they found wind, and Ben rushed back to the boat to help Luke prepare the sails, and they were off.
Wind!
Yeah, fine, Luke. Okay?
Yeah, it's good.
The sails were full of wind, and their hearts were full of unrelenting hope that this time the Lahakai would make it all the way.
When are we arriving?
When?
Exactly, I want to know. When's my next beer?
It'd be Friday. Morning.
Today is...
Today's Tuesday.
Tuesday night. What time is it now? Six.
Six.
But when the next morning came, the wind was nowhere to be found. Ben was resting from his watch, and the colors of the sunrise could almost make one forget that the forecast had changed and did not look promising.
Finally in some wind. The reason for that is we were stuck behind that island over there behind me. So that tip over there is the tip of Ilhabela. And once we've reached that, it's literally a straight line to Itajaí. If you have a look at my watch, which is the running watch, but you can see here, the red arrow is us and the white arrow is where we're heading to. That's all you need, right? 470 kilometers. To go. Really hope this wind keeps up. I think you've had a good look at the map right now. I don't know if you saw, we've got Santos here on the right, which is where we left with MP, MP's dad, Marco, to Navegantes. Now that leads into the furthest, most inland part. So now we are the furthest away from land, and there's a gradual, it's called slope of Brazilian coast, well, our route and the coast meet each other. So from now on, meter by meter, we'll be closer and closer to the coast. And also, there's 170 miles to go, which is on my watch, I've got 303 kilometers. In about, it's saying 30 hours. We'll see what happens. That would be tomorrow at lunchtime. But yeah, we can't trust the wind. Has picked up for sure, but unfortunately so have the waves. And I don't know about you, comment down below what you think, but downwind sailing is super tough, especially when you got waves coming from all over the places here. I don't know, it's a pool. It's a pool party.
So that was fun.
Casually here, having a nap. Of course, we don't have any windows.
On this journey, we have learned about many things that we have to fix. And you can add this to the list too. Enlarging the drain pipes in the cockpit for faster drainage. On the sixth night, the wind dropped and the guys entered a fog whose silence was deafening. They were at the height of Paranagua in Paraná, and to make it worse, they began to see lightning. This was the only moment in the trip where it was truly scary. For a brief moment, they thought about rerouting to Paranagua, but the sea had an incredible surprise in store. Fog lifted and the wind began to enter in increasingly high speeds. They reefed the mainsail and furled the Genoa, and the Lahakai was really put to the test with 40 knot winds. She heeled aggressively, and the clash of empty steel on the waves made a deafening noise inside the boat. Whatever was not tied down was thrown about, but we could feel that the Lahakai was in her true form. Looking back, we can't help but feel an immense swell of pride that we built a really strong, safe, and navigable boat. And now the guys were really enjoying the moment, surfing the huge waves and sailing with their hearts.
Better than a roller coaster.
Saturday.
I've done it.
Today is the fifth day of sailing, and we're finally being able to recognize some homey land points. So behind us, we've got Itacolomi, Ilha Feia, the ugly island. You can even see the beach that's in front of our house. We actually called up MP and Lorraine recently, and they were actually being able to see us from where we live. So it's really, really nice to have this feeling that we're finally making it. I'm sorry we haven't been able to show much action in this video. It's just because there's only two of us, no autopilot, no wind vane. So one of us always had to do the action while the other one was holding a course or even helping out. So for example, now we're gonna have to get into the marina, but there's a bunch of container ships all over the place. So rather we focus a lot on getting in safe. We've got an emergency anchor. Well, it wasn't actually here for that reason. It fell in the sea, which was one of the things that happened on the chain. So it's here for now, and some line, and that's our emergency brake. And then in case of anything, we can always just chuck the dinghy in the water while we're at anchor and figure out the rest.
We can't tell you how many amazing people we've met along the way who have altered the direction of our lives. And we look back knowing that if we didn't make that mistake, or if we decided to do that thing differently, we might not be standing here right now. Got a perfectly good boat and bypassed all this insane construction, would we know the things we do today? Where would we have ended up? We certainly wouldn't be here sharing this journey with you. Thank you. we continue to make mistakes. We take steps forward, and sometimes we fall back. Our path isn't linear, much like sailing a sailboat. Sometimes you fight the wind, sometimes you flow with it. You look at your compass, and you may know the way, but that doesn't mean you don't have moments when you feel lost. And in those times where the weather has turned, the wind has ceased, or the land is a distant memory, we have been continuously surprised by the kindness and generosity of others. The people that have shown up when least expected, the ones who have given when not even asked, and the ones who have helped a total stranger. We stumble around this world of negativity, feeling almost undeserving of the kindness we have been shown. It seems there are so many more lessons for us to learn. The ocean has a funny way of getting you to see the world in a different way.
What's the story, guys?
Yeah.
Where do we start?
It all began.
Can I have a baki?